between the globe to bring you the constant variety of sport, the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat, the human drama of athletic competition. This is ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Good afternoon. I'm Jim McKay speaking to you from Darlington, South Carolina. This is kind of small town day on Wide World of Sports. Darlington here, for example, has a population of about 6,000. And it's a long way from any place. 80 miles from Columbia, 110 miles from Charlotte. But today, lots of people are here. Between 75 and 80,000 people, as a matter of fact, gathered here at the Darlington Raceway to see the Southern 500, one of the classics of American stock car racing. A good many miles from here, at another small town in New Mexico, there's going to be speed and action of another kind. Let's go to Larry Berlesi. Darlington, South Carolina. It's the Southern 500 Stock Car Championship. This is the way the summer ends in South Carolina, with a kind of a mass picnic and cookout, with fireworks and sleeping under the stars and building improvised grandstands on top of cars and pickup trucks. These people here, almost unbelievably, started arriving more than 24 hours ago. They've been here all night and are now massed some 35,000 strong in the infield with another 40,000 in the grandstands, awaiting the climax of their weekend, the Southern 500 Stock Car Race. These people come from all over the South, as a matter of fact, from all 50 of the United States. We're told, by the way, that one group even came down from Canada last year, finally got within a half mile of the racetrack, couldn't budge an inch further, couldn't get any tickets, and just didn't get in. This is kind of the Southern version of the station wagon tailgate set in the Ivy League. But the race is the thing today, and the prize money is big. $95,000, with almost $20,000 going to the winner. It'll be the Southern 500 here, and it's just about a minute or two until starting time now for the race that ends the summertime in South Carolina.
Up here on the roof of the pagoda is where we're going to be calling the race for you as it progresses through the afternoon. Very simply, the Southern 500 works this way. 500 miles for late model stock cars. 1960, 61, and 62, American automobiles, Pontiacs, Plymouths, Fords, and other makes. All the great drivers are here. Fireball Roberts is on hand, of course. And so is Joe Weatherly and Ned Jarrett and Buck and Buddy Baker. In our other announced position, Chris Economaki, the editor of National Speed Sport News, is standing by, ready to bring you the human side of the story. Chris?
Down here, we'll be looking at closely at the cars and drivers and bringing you the pit reports. The reports from here are that the temperature is 90 degrees and climbing, with the asphalt at 111 degrees right now. So we're going to do it informally later on. Back to you, Jim McKay.
Okay, Chris. Well, that's the way we're set up to cover the race this afternoon. Right now, however, let's meet some of the men who are going to make the sports news. Let's look at the drivers.
Like Johnny Allen, born in Los Angeles, he's a Southerner now from North Wilkes-Barre, North Carolina. He was third here last year. And here, moving into the picture is, I believe it's Bobby Johns. Yeah. Now, there's Bobby, the garage operator from Miami, operates the garage along with his dad. Both of them will be driving Pontiac. Bobby Johns got a third here one year not long ago, too. Here's Fireball Roberts, a quiet, slow-spoken fellow from Florida who is the most famous stock car driver in all the world. He's the favorite. He had the top qualifying speed of over 130 miles an hour. He really moves. This is Joe Weatherly, 40 years old. He's a veteran from Norfolk, Virginia. Kind of the jokester on the tour. Everybody likes him, but he's never done too well here at Darlington. Not yet, anyway. This is Pearson, 27 years old, one of the younger drivers. Moving into the picture, Larry Frank. He could be in there. We'll be back in just a moment, then, with the start of the Southern 500. The Gillette Safety Razor Company is bringing you this segment of ABC's Wide World of Sports. Now here they come, a field of 44 cars strung out behind the pace car, headed for the starting line, less than a minute away from that flag that will send them on their way. In the field are 13 Fords, 13 Pontiacs, 8 Chevrolets, 3 Plymouths, 3 Mercurys, 2 Chryslers, and 2 Dodges, all late model American automobiles. The pole winner, we told you, was Fireball Roberts with a qualifying speed of over 130 miles an hour. However, Fireball, as was his right, elected not to be on the pole, but to be on the outside of that same lane. So as he comes at our camera for the start, he will be on the left of your screen. And on the right, actually, on the pole will be Junior Johnson, who had the second fastest qualifying speed. Behind them, Fred Lorenzen, Bobby Johns, Joe Weatherly, Dick Petty, Dave Pearson. It's a good start, and there goes Roberts off to a sensational start. Johnson, just the opposite, spun his wheels a little bit. You may have seen the smoke. No trouble with his engine, just his wheels not getting traction at the beginning, and Johnson falling back quickly. Roberts, however, off to that fast start, was followed closely by the two cars behind him in the lineup. Those two cars were Bobby Johns in number 72 and Richard Petty of Ravenna, North Carolina, in car number 43. Dick Petty, the 25-year-old son of Lee Petty, one of the most famous of the stock car drivers. Dick Petty driving a Plymouth in third position, the other two out in front, both in Pontiacs. So, as is the case so many times in stock car races, wherever they're held, the famous number 22, the number that is always painted on the side of the car driven by Fireball Roberts, is quickly out in front. Bobby Johns, however, as you see, right with him, and so is Dick Petty. There's a little way to go yet, almost 500 miles. They're running on the very slick asphalt surface, and perhaps you can actually see it glisten from the rays of the sun here at Darlington, South Carolina. The temperature, looking at our thermometer here, is now up to 95, and that's in the shade. That means the track temperature somewhere around 125, 130 degrees. And what happens is that this asphalt begins to melt, and the cars are actually slipping and sliding around in it. That's why there's always plenty. There's action right away. Number five, spinning out, hit by another car, and going down into the dirt, but apparently it's going to be all right. That's number five, driven by a rookie, H.G. Rozier of Augusta, Georgia, who very quickly finds out about the slippery surface of Darlington. However, he's still in the race. However, he lost valuable seconds already with that first accident of the day. So the leaders were not affected in any way by the accident. Roberts still in front, John still second, and Petty third. It's 22, 72, and 43. Those are the leaders. Behind them, trying to pick out some of the others. In fourth position is Fred Lorenzen. Number 28, number six, Dave Pearson is in fifth, and Joe Weatherly, number eight, has sixth at the moment. So those are the leaders. The sun glinting off the windshield, and inside those cars, you can't imagine how furiously hot it is. Now, let's clock a lap on Fireball Roberts. He's the leader. See the clock on your screen there. And anywhere around 39 or 40 seconds will be very fast time. We'll translate that into miles per hour for you just as soon as the lap is completed. Roberts on the backstretch, and now moving into the third turn. This is a turn where passing can be done. On the first two, it's very difficult, but on this turn three and now turn four, cars can be passed. At the moment, however, Roberts is not about to be passed. He's headed into the home stretch, coming to the line now. There it is, 39 and 4/10 seconds. Let's see, that's a speed of 125.635 miles per hour. That means on the straightaway, he's going even faster than that, about 135. Roberts seeming to drive almost effortlessly, but from that reading, you know there's plenty of effort involved to go that speed on this track on this particular day. All of the drivers approach this one, by the way, like the big car drivers approach Indianapolis or the European drivers approach Le Mans. And here's another car just hit the pit wall. You just saw the tail end of it there as his left rear fender, the car driven by Roscoe Thompson of Atlanta, Georgia, car number 81, hit the pit wall, and there's what's left of one of his tires. Well, we'll be back in just a moment with more of the action from the Southern 500 on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Back at Darlington, South Carolina again, and the cars have now passed the 50-lap mark. They've gone better than one-seventh of the way. All told, there are 364 laps comprising a 500-mile race on this track, which is 1 3/8 miles in distance. It's just about an oval track here at Darlington. However, one of the big, long turns is a little more difficult than the other one.
the turn that they call the first and second turn combined, the one that they're going into right now, is almost impossible to pass on unless one car is going very slow, as you saw there a moment ago, and the other one just takes him high. However, when they come into turns 3 and 4, it is possible to pass another vehicle, and that has happened a couple of times today. However, at this moment, it is not happening to the leader, not to any of the first 3 leaders, because there's no remaining save, and there goes car number 81, which hit the pit wall earlier, spinning out. Roscoe Thompson of Atlanta having a lot of trouble this afternoon, but once again, it looks like he's still in the race unless the car is stalled down. Now, it looks like he'll be able to start up again. Thompson's going to go. Now, here you have car 8, that's Joe Weatherly, moving out in front of car 6, which is David Pearson. They're beginning to wage a pretty good battle for 5th place here. The way the cars stand right now is this. Fireball Roberts in car number 22 is still the leader. In 2nd place, car number 72, Bobby John. In 3rd place, car number 43, Dick Petty. Moving up into 4th place is Junior Johnson, who was on the pole but got off to a bad start. Now, once again, we're clocking Fireball Roberts, the leader, to see what his speed is at this point. Junior Johnson has moved into 4th place, and as we said a moment ago, car number 8, Joe Weatherly, car number 6, David Pearson, are now waging a real good ding-dong battle for 5th place. Behind them in 7th and 8th come Fred Lorenzen in car number 28 and Marvin Panch in car number 21. Remember once again that any speed of 40 seconds or under is real fast under any conditions on this track, and especially today with this hot sun, the soft condition of the asphalt. Here he comes to the finish line, and this time we get 39.6 seconds, which is a speed of precisely 125 miles an hour, right to the thousandth of a second. And the thousandth of a mile per hour, to be more precise. Bobby Johns now moving up even closer to Fireball Roberts than he was before. He's been hanging right in there within 100 feet of Fireball ever since they left the starting line a good long while ago now. Remember, the Johns was right behind Roberts in the starting position, and he stayed right there. Looks like he's going to try to take him now. Let's see if he can make it. Johns making his move, but as they go into the turn, doesn't look like he can quite take him this time. Fireball hanging on the high side. They go along down the backstretch now, almost side by side. The crowd, which from time to time gets itself a soda or passes the time of day, now suddenly turning its attention right back to the track again, as Bobby Johns has taken the lead, has passed for Fireball Roberts, just as they were behind a sign there, just out of sight of the cameras. Johns moved past Roberts, made his move coming into the turn, and has taken over the lead. So that's the big news from Darlington right now. Bobby Johns of Miami, Florida is the leader. Fireball Roberts has fallen back into 2nd place, but he's less than a second behind. In 3rd position still, Dick Petty of Randleman, North Carolina. And here in car number 19 is a fellow named Herman Bean. He isn't slowing down to go into the pits or slowing down to drop out of the race. That's the way Herman drives. He drives only to finish, and by finishing, he makes himself a good pile of money every year. As a matter of fact, Herman Bean has finished more races than Fireball Roberts, believe it or not. And incidentally, he looks like he's out for a Sunday drive, but he is averaging about 90 miles an hour, which gives you an idea of how fast these cars are going, particularly the leader, 72, Bobby Johns, over 125 miles an hour. We'll be back in just a moment with more of the action from the Southern 500 on ABC's Wide World of Sports. In the Southern 500 at Darlington, South Carolina, the leaders have now completed more than 70 laps. The temperature has risen to 96 degrees, and the special thermometer that takes the actual temperature of the track itself now reads 145 degrees. That'll give you an idea of what it's like inside the cabin of one of these late model stock cars. Inside the cabin, for example, of car number 72, the leader, driven by Bobby Johns of Miami. There's number 22. And his car is out of control against the steel fence. He's getting it back under control, but it looks like bad damage. It looks like he could have lost the wheel. Certainly has lost his front right tire. And to try to backtrack, Fireball Roberts was just coming in for a pit stop.
Here is Fireball. There, bad trouble for the car in second place and the biggest name perhaps in stock car racing, Fireball Roberts. Chris McConaughey, what's the story?
Fireball's coming in with a damaged right front. He apparently collapsed the right front tire. Man, the pits here. The crews are coming out. They've got a lot of work to do down here. Here is the favorite. If we can get over on the front, get up front, on the front corner, there's going to be extensive work that has to be redone. We'll see now as they evaluate the damage as to exactly what the story is here. The right front suspension unit seems to be broken off. Fireball is going to get out. He's going to get out of the car. Here he's coming out now. Roberts is getting out of the car. A tough break here. Tough luck, Fireball.
What's that thing down there? I got in a lot of sand coming into the pits and went up and hit the rail. Looks like I knocked out the right front corner.
Oh, that's a tough break. There's the favorite early leader, Fireball Roberts, taking it philosophically, being knocked out of the 12th renewal, perhaps the 13th Southern 500. Bad luck for the Fireball.
Okay, Chris. Here's Bobby Johns coming in for his first pit stop. He's the leader in the race and now has more of a lead than he had before because Fireball Roberts is out of the race, possibly completely for the afternoon, certainly for a good long time to come. Bobby Johns, the leader, he trails Roberts for
Jim, he's definitely out. The right front suspension unit is broken completely off the car. It is irreparable in any short length of time.
Okay, well, there you hear the story from the pits. Fireball Roberts out of the race. There is your leader. Bobby Johns going back onto the track. Coming into the pits now is Dick Petty. Chris Economaki, are you anywhere near Petty down there? Richard Petty, who is now in second place in the race, with Fireball Roberts suddenly and startlingly dropping out of the competition, Dick Petty is very much in it. The leader, of course, is Bobby Johns in car number 72, but Dick Petty here in car number 43 is now in second place, having his first routine pit stop of the afternoon. Things seem to be going well. Okay, there he goes. Dick Petty back on the course. And where there were three leaders, now there are two. This one's gone, Fireball Roberts. The end of a day that could have meant victory. Well, he's won a lot of them, but you can bet he's lost a lot of them before, too. He knows how to take it. But there goes his car being towed away. Quick reminder here, by the way, that next Saturday, ABC's Wide World of Sports is going to bring you exclusive coverage of the first race for the America's Cup, the greatest boating race in the world, on the Atlantic Ocean off Newport, Rhode Island, for the America's Cup, Australia against the United States. Also next Saturday, the World Mixed Doubles Bowling Championship. Back on the track now. As we said, where there were three, there are two. Bobby Johns in car number 72 is the leader. In second place, we have Dick Petty of Randleman, North Carolina. That means that Junior Johnson, who got off to a bad start from his pole position, has now moved up into third position. In fourth place, we have David Pearson, who has moved ahead of Joe Weatherly. Joe Weatherly is fifth in car number 8. Behind him in sixth place comes Fred Lorenzen. In seventh place, car number 21, Marvin Pant. So the race has really begun to take its toll. The cars are just about at the 100-mile mark. To backtrack just a bit on that Fireball Roberts story, he was actually slowed down, headed in for his first routine pit stop, when, as you heard him say, he suddenly hit some sand. The car went completely out of control, spun from the low side of the curve, way up onto the high side, slammed into that steel railing, and tore off the right front side of the car, and that was it for the Fireball. Really shocked this crowd. Bobby Johns the leader, Dick Petty second, and now Junior Johnson third.
We'll be back in just a moment with more of the action from the Southern 500 on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Now here's a word from Liberty Mutual Insurance. And now we finish lap number 120 for the leader, and the leader still remains car number 72, Bobby Johns of Miami, Florida. And he's stretching it out a bit. The car that was in second place, number 43, driven by Dick Petty, has fallen back quite a bit. He has gone from second place all the way back to fifth. Here's the way they stand right now. At the end of 120 laps, if Bobby Johns is car number 72 in first place and moving up into second, the car that got off to such a bad start from the pole position, number 3, driven by Junior Johnson. Johnson now second. In third place is car number 28, driven by Fred Lorenzen of Illinois. Fourth place, car number 6, driven by David Pearson. And in fifth place, car number 43, as we said, driven by Dick Petty. And now we're clocking the leader again, Bobby Johns. Take another lap on him and see what his speed has been. The average speed, well over the record for the Darlington course so far today. Remember that anything 40 seconds or below is really fast time. On the backstretch now and moving into the third turn. Pacing himself nicely. That's the fourth turn, and now getting ready to head into the home stretch. Here he comes, down to that finish line. Far from the last time, 39.3 we get him in. 125.9 miles per hour. And here we have a collision on the second turn. Between the first and second turn, it's cars number 84 and 47. That's red-footed car number 84 from Southington, Connecticut. In car number 47, excuse me, we have Ralph Earnhardt of Kannapolis, North Carolina. That is Earnhardt's car there, I believe. He caught the numbers as the two of them collided, and they may very well be out of action for the rest of this afternoon. So the spills and crashes continue here at Darlington. There have been plenty of them. And the yellow flag goes down. That's the caution flag, meaning that all the cars must fall in behind the leader and hold place until the course has been cleared and until the green flag again is waved. They see the safety car out on the course. It's been out more than once today. There's smoke now rising from Ralph Earnhardt's car as he pulls her away. But as you can see, that car's in pretty bad shape. The front bumper ripped off. A couple of flat tires, probably. And I would venture to guess that Ralph Earnhardt, driving Jack Smith's car, has had it for this afternoon. 44 cars started. We now have about, we haven't run yet, 27 cars left on the track. Out of 44, 27 are now left. We've gone about 122 laps. Yellow flag still down. Probably keep it down until Earnhardt gets into the pits there with his badly damaged car. Other cars making routine pit stops, taking advantage of the caution flag to get their pit stop in while the other cars are going slowly. Joe Weatherly's down the pits right now. I think Chris Conomacki's there.
Here we are now with Joe Weatherly's second stop of the race. They're handing him water. How's it out there, Joe?
It's awful warm out there, Chris. It's not as hot as I expected it to be, but it's still warm out here today.
Joe's busy here. We got a little bit. He's very hot. They're giving him some water there. He seems very calm in the car as the tires are being changed, taking advantage of the caution lights here. Weatherly puts his car in gear. He was very kind to let us get on here, and I'll be roaring back out in the pits in just a moment. And back to you, Jim McKay.
Okay, Chris. And there you see that poor wreck of a car, Jack Smith's car, driven by Earnhardt today. But not going to be driven any longer in this race. Looks like they're just going to drive it right to the junkie. However, back on the course, there is Fred Lorenzen, who at the moment, because of various cars on pit stops, is the leader. However, Bobby Johns, when he completes his pit stop, probably will still be in front. 126 laps have been completed. There's Fred Lorenzen. He calls himself the only Yankee on the tour. Most of these drivers are Southern boys. Fred, by the way, is driving an air-conditioned car, the first time that an air-conditioned car has ever been driven in major stock car competition. He figures it should help him a lot in endurance when this race gets to the closing stages. And right now, Fred has been moving up very nicely. He's the only cool fella out there, you can be sure of that. We have Joe Weatherly and David Pearson colliding at that spot that's been the trouble spot all day between just coming off the first turn. And that could have been a lot worse than it turned out to be because those cars really smacked each other. There's Joe Weatherly's car, number eight. Number six is David Pearson. Dave, one of the younger fellas, is 27 years old. Joe, the veteran, 40 years old. And again, the yellow flag goes down. Remember that despite all the yellow flags, the speed is still high. And now here is Bobby Johns, who has been the leader in the pits with a flat tire just a few moments after the crash between Joe Weatherly and David Pearson, two of the other leaders. The situation very confused and very fluid at this point. And Bobby Johns there is having his tire changed to see if they have any difficulty getting it out from under the defender. Seems to be a little bent there. Now looks like it'll be okay. Also trying to see if he can get that lead back as soon as he gets out of there. There's David Pearson. Just went by. You saw him. He was coming into the pit for a pit stop. Everybody coming in for either scheduled or unscheduled pit stops at this point. Here again is Johns. And he is losing valuable seconds here all the time on this tire change. This is certainly not one of the faster pit stops of the day. And there they are having trouble, as you see, with that dented fender. He must have hit the steel retaining wall up there and bent it enough to lose him a lot of time on this pit stop. Joe Weatherly has just come into there. There's Joe Weatherly coming into the pits after his crash with David Pearson and a very flat right front tire for him. Just about all of the leaders are now out of action, except for Richard Petty, who had dropped back all the way to fifth place. He and Fred Lorenzen are now the two leaders out on the course, along with Junior Johnson. Lorenzen, the leader at the moment, with Petty second, and Junior Johnson third. Chris Akatamaki, are you near the situation down there?
Yes, we are, and it's a Mexican speed wrench, as they say in the stock car racing business, a sledgehammer being swung heavily here by chief mechanic Bud Moore. Joe is waiting. We'll see what Joe has to say about what happened out there as they work on the car. We're going to have a few moments here. Joe, what happened this time?
Dave Pierce thinks it's a quarter-mile racetrack, so they run down and run the direct smack in the wall. I think he's driving a little over his head.
Did you get hurt at all, Joe? You're not hurt, are you?
I'm not hurt, but you ought to put that Dave Pierce in the hospital. His brain's hurt.
I see. Well, there's Joe Weatherly's comments from right from the cockpit, and he's a mad man outside on one of the other drivers. The work is going to be accomplished here. The right front quarter section of the car has got a new wheel on it, being buttoned on now, but there's jagged metal showing there. It's going to be a dangerous thing on the track, but they're going to get him back out with a lap or two behind, I'm sure. Now back to you, Jim McKay.
Okay, Chris. Well, sure was an angry man, was Joe Weatherly, the 40-year-old, kind of chewing out the 27-year-old David Pearson. You heard him. He said that David ought to be in the hospital. His brain's hurting. Well, word said in the heat of battle, they'll probably talk it over a little bit after the race. And that was a near thing for both Pearson and Weatherly. Now, trying to sort out these cars at the pit stop. Fred Lorenzen is still the leader, but by the time the pit stops are completed, Dick Petty possibly could take the lead back from him again. And Junior Johnson is very much in contention. Fred Lorenzen, the leader. We'll be back in a moment with more of the action from the Southern 500 in Darlington, South Carolina, on ABC's Wide World of Sport. Now here's a message about something new I know will really click with you. The leaders have passed the halfway mark in the Southern 500 at Darlington, South Carolina. And the car in first place is a new one. Number three, Junior Johnson, off to a bad start. He's battled his way back up through the pack and has now taken over the lead from 25-year-old Dick Petty. Remember, Petty in car number 43 took over the lead. He and Fred Lorenzen battling for it after Bobby Johns had to drop out. Now we'll clock the leader on one lap. This is Junior Johnson out in front of the field and going very nicely. We'll get a speed on him around the first turn. Larry Frank has moved into third place, by the way. He has not been in contention up to this point. Look out! The leader's in trouble. Never mind the time. Junior Johnson has hit the rail, and we can't see the damage yet, but this is a real tough spin. He's got it under control now. Whew. The tires appear to be all right. Looks like he'll be able to go on, but Junior Johnson has lost the lead. Dick Petty is back in the lead now with Larry Frank in car number 66 in second place. Things stand at this moment at Darlington, South Carolina in the Southern 500. And lots more action coming up here. We'll be returning for the climax, for the moment of decision, for the payoff at the end of this race in just a little while. Right now, briefly, we're going to throw you, however, to Ruidoso Downs, New Mexico, and Larry Berlepi. We have a lot more action coming up here at Darlington, South Carolina. However, a little while ago, you may remember, we mentioned to you that next Saturday, ABC's Wide World of Sports is going to bring you exclusive coverage of the first race for the America's Cup between Weatherly and the Australian boat Gradle. Now, earlier this week, I spoke to Bus Mosbacher, the American skipper. Well, that was a talk I had earlier this week with Bus Mosbacher. So be sure to see ABC's Wide World of Sports exclusive coverage of the America's Cup next Saturday afternoon. Right now, we're back at Darlington, South Carolina in the Southern 500, and the race has really moved to the critical stage. They've completed 345 laps. They're only about 22 miles to go out of the 500 they had to go when they started. The leader at this point, in car number 43, is Dick Petty of Randleman, North Carolina. There he is. We're going to clock him, get his speed on this lap. In second place is the unknown, virtually, although he's been on the trail a long time, car number 66, Larry Frank, who was not in contention in the early going, but is now very much in contention. He's in second place, although he, the last time we clocked him, was some 27 seconds behind the leader, Dick Petty. So Dick Petty has a good, solid lead with 22 miles to go, but everything has been happening in this race this afternoon, so stand by. And in third place at the moment is Junior Johnson, who was in the lead at one point, but spun out, fell back, but he has been moving up steadily out ever since and could again challenge for the lead before this race is over. 25-year-old Dick Petty completes that lap in 39 and 2/10 seconds, which is very good time. That's an average of 126.276 miles per hour. A torrid pace under the torrid sun of South Carolina. There is car number 66. Now let's see if the second place car is going faster than the first place car. That's the way we can tell whether car number 66 here, Larry Frank, is catching up on the leader. You can't tell with the naked eye because, as we said, he's almost a half a lap behind. But he's been moving very fast. We have an idea that he may be gaining. Remember, 39.2 seconds was the time for one lap for the leader, Dick Petty. Larry Frank now, moving around that fourth turn and towards the home stretch. He's really moving. There he comes towards the finish line, and watch the clock. 38.7. That is an average speed of 127.9 miles per hour. So he's doing more than about a mile and a half better per hour than the leader. We may have quite a finish this afternoon. Now, neither of these cars have had their final pit stop yet, and almost certainly they will have to take them. Junior Johnson might be able to make it without one. Oh, by the way, there's Herman Dean. I mentioned him earlier. He's the fellow who drives the finish, not to win. Well, as we said before, it looks like he's going slowly. He's only averaging about 90 miles an hour. Wait a minute. Here's the second place car now coming in for what should be his final scheduled pit stop of the day. Larry Frank of Greenville, South Carolina. Larry, at the age of 31, has never won a really big stock car race. He'd love to do it this afternoon. He was a real sleeper in the early going. He didn't get a call because he was well back in the pack. Since the others just had dropped out, he kept coming along. Watch this pit stop. We're clocking it for you. Looks like it's going to be a real fast one, and it'll have to be if he's going to gain on Dick Petty. 2 said he's about 27 seconds behind Dick Petty the last time we clocked him on the distance between the two cars. There's 30 seconds, and he's almost ready to go. There goes the last bit of gas washing into that tank. He doesn't need too much. There's only about 20 miles left. 36 seconds, a real good, fast pit stop. And now, while that was going on, Dick Petty, the leader, also came into the pit. Not so fast on his pit stop. He came in almost immediately after Larry Frank did, and he still sits there. Looks like Petty is losing time. We get it at 52 seconds for his pit stop. That is a total gain of some 14 seconds. And here's Junior Johnson coming in for a quick final pit stop. Hit, that's the third place car, changing a tire. Dick Petty, by the way, did not change a tire on that stop. He got the okay from his tire man, it looked like, and went back out on the track. So now Dick Petty, car number 43, lead number 66, Larry Frank, by just about 11 seconds. There's Junior Johnson going out of the pit. So, 1-2-3 should be quite a battle here for the rest of the way.
Look out, there's a bad one. Again, in between the first and second cars. Again, I got the number. It's 46, that's Johnny Allen. The car going on a cruise. Gideon now is catching on fire. Johnny is not out of there yet. No injury so far to David. Here he comes. He's made it. Now the car bursts into flame. If he had been in that car for 2 seconds longer, Johnny Allen's career would have been at an end. The closest thing to a real tragedy we had this afternoon here at Darlington. Allen kind of rode off suddenly along that rail and skidded along the top of the rail for it. Oh, it seemed like 2 or 3 seconds. Then as you saw the car somersaulted, hit down on its roof and skidded out into the infield. Johnny held in there by the seatbelt. You can be sure his life was saved by his seatbelt and by the sturdy roll bars that are built into these stock racing cars. Oh, that one shook you up a little bit, I'll tell you that. Johnny has made it. We can see with our binoculars now, he's moved off to the side and does not seem to be injured at all. And needless to say, the yellow flag is down again. Telling the cars to hold pace behind the safety car. Now, this makes quite a difference in the race. Dick Petty was about 11, 12 seconds ahead of Larry Frank. But although the cars have to hold pace, they don't have to stay the same distance apart. So Larry Frank has pulled up to just behind Dick Petty. In other words, when the green flag goes down again, they'll be battling for the lead just about a second between them. We'll be back in just a moment with more of the action from the Southern 500 on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Now, Ken.
Well, we've just gotten definite and very good news from the pit that Johnny Allen, believe it or not, is unscratched. The only thing he scratched in that flaming crash of his car was the crystal of his watch. A real good break. And in the race now, moving into the closing stages, it is a battle very much to the liking of these home fans here in South Carolina. A battle between South Carolina and North Carolina. In the lead, Dick Petty from Randleman, North Carolina. Second place, number 66, is Larry Frank of Greenville, South Carolina. Third place is Junior Johnson of Ronda, North Carolina. It couldn't be set up better for the folks down here. At the moment, Petty is still the leader, but Larry Frank is really challenging him. Frank, who came from way off the pace. As a matter of fact, just Frank trying to, made a move as if he was going to try to take him, but he couldn't do it on the straightaway. Once they got into that first turn, he couldn't do it. But Dick Petty is still the leader in that blue Plymouth. Second place in the Ford, Larry Frank. There you see the difference between the two cars as they went across the finish line, 1/10 of a second at 125 miles an hour. Now the question is whether each of these cars will stop for a quick final pit stop. You can be sure they're thinking about that. And there he goes. Frank is making his move again, and this time it looks like he might make it. He's got it. Larry Frank has taken over the lead for the first time this afternoon. Larry Frank of South Carolina, now ahead of Dick Petty of North Carolina. Sir,
third place, Junior Johnson, who's still in the fight, but a good way back at the moment. Now, looking at the scoreboard, you see that the scoreboard does not agree with our computation. The scoreboard shows, look at Dick Petty there. He actually bumped into Frank's car. Actually gave him a little nudge. The scoreboard, however, does not agree with us. The scoreboard shows that Larry Frank is a lap behind. Now, our figures do not show that. Our figures show the cars just the way you see them. Frank in first place and Petty in second. We will report that the scoreboard, which is more official than we are, shows Frank a lap behind and Petty as the leader, with Johnson second. Well, we'll check out on that. Have somebody go up to the official scores and see what the story is. We'll stay with Frank as the leader, however, for right now. See, they've gone a long way this afternoon, and the temperature is not getting any cooler. It's still 95 or 96 degrees, and the track temperature must be unbelievable. The last official reading on the track we had was 145. It's probably hotter than that now. There is the owner of the car being driven by Larry Frank. That is Radis Walters, and it looks like maybe there is a little bit of controversy on who's ahead down there in the pits. But Radis goes back to his job of signaling his car, Larry Frank. Now there, you see the way the scoreboard has them. They have Dick Petty still leading with 66. Larry Frank almost a lap behind. Junior Johnson now third. So they've changed that again. But they still have Petty as the leader by almost a lap, by just a second less than a lap, over Larry Frank. However, he says, we show Larry Frank out in front. So, controversy and a bit of confusion reigns in the closing moments of the Southern 500. Well, it's been that kind of a day. A wild and woolly day in college. And the word from upstairs is that the officials say that's it, that Petty is in first place. Well, if so, there he is. And if not, there's Larry Frank, who is in first place. One of the two of them is in first place. Take your choice. And there are many vantage points to watch this race, even the telegraph poles. All right, and here comes Frank into the pits right now. Chris Conomacki, can you hear me down there now?
Yes, I do, and Larry Frank is coming in here right now. There's lots of excitement. The car is grinding to a halt here, and the crewmen are rushing over. We're trying to stay out of their way. He's getting things. We don't want to get in their way. The tires seem okay. Everything looks all right. They're just putting some gas in.
How do they think they stand, Chris?
They're sending him out in a very lightning-like stop. It's remarkable. We didn't even have a chance to talk to Larry. The crew did a great job. The owner of the car, Radis Walters, is right here. I want to get a word with him.
All right, Chris, we got a timing on that of 15 6/10 seconds, an incredibly fast pit stop.
That's a remarkable stop. We're going to ask the owner of the car over here.
Right. Go ahead.
That was a great stop. Your crew is well trained. I understand you feel that the car is leading rather than running second. Is that right?
Yeah, I think so. I don't know how they managed to put Teddy up front of us.
Do you plan to protest this if they keep it this way on the scoreboard?
Well, if you want to put it like that, I just want to look at the scores. I feel that we passed him twice. We beat him in the pit stop time last time. And I think now we're behind him, but not a whole lap, so I'm gonna look at the scoreboard anyway.
I see. Well, that's a story from the Larry Frank pick, Jim McKay.
Okay, Chris. And here is Dick Petty coming into the pit, who may or may not be the leader. Now remember, the officials say that this car is the lead car. However, the owner of car number 66, driven by Larry Frank, disagrees. Says that he thinks he's out in the lead. And my figures show the car number 66 is in the lead, and my spotter's figures here show the same thing. So it's impossible to tell you who the leader is right now. There's 43, the official leader. I guess we'll have to call Frank the unofficial leader. Chris is down there near Dick Petty's dad right now.
Well, that was a 12-second stop, about the same as Larry Frank. How far ahead do you feel your boy is?
We're just about three-quarters of a lap ahead right now.
I see there's some talk up at the other end that the standings are not correct. How do you feel about this?
Well, I hope they're right.
I see. Well, that's Lee Petty, who just sent his boy out in a 12-second pit stop, the final one of the race.
Well, another vote has been cast. Lee Petty thinks that his son Dick Petty's in front. However, Larry Frank, owner of his car, thinks he's in the lead. We'll be back in just a moment with more of the action from the Southern 500 in Darlington, South Carolina, on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Now here's a word from Liberty Mutual Insurance. Now here's the story from the officials. The officials say definitely that Dick Petty is the leader in this race, with just a few laps left to go, about five laps left. Dick Petty is the leader, with Junior Johnson here in second place and moving up fast. We're clocking a lap here on Junior Johnson in second position. Larry Frank is in third place, almost a full lap behind these two cars. So in the closing moments of the race now, it's a battle between 43 and 3. And number three, Junior Johnson from Rumner, North Carolina, really coming on. Look, he's right on the tail of the leader. 38.6 seconds we got him that time. That's 128.2 miles per hour. That's as fast as anybody's gone all day today. Three, trying to get by 43. It's that simple now. After almost 500 miles, it's down to these two cars, and there goes Johnson into the lead. And Petty is dropping back. I think he's blown a tire. It looks like Dick Petty has blown a tire just as Junior Johnson was passing him. The two things could have happened just about simultaneously, and Johnson now is out in front all by himself. There you see Dick Petty with rubber flying off his left front tire. The tire just about completely off the wheel now. It's completely off the wheel. Well, a little bit of rubber left there, I guess. Yeah, they're still bouncing off the tire. See if Dick comes into the pit. Look, more rubber coming off. And the car's swerving now. Look out. Petty having trouble controlling it. I think he did touch the rail there. Riding now on the bare steel of his left front wheel, and it looks like he's going to keep going. Looks like he's going to stay out there and try to finish the race and finish as high up as he can. However, he's out of the battle for the lead just in the closing moments. Junior Johnson is your leader right now. Larry Frank in second place, almost a lap behind. And the other positions will have to be straightened out here with Dick Petty dropping way back here. He's losing a place probably every 15, 20 seconds here. He's going to stick it out, though. Dick Petty, the son of Lee Petty, one of the all-time great stock car drivers, and Lee in the pits, looking down on him, looks like a pretty sad man right now. Dick rode a little bit high that time, almost got in the way of the other cars. You can see having a terrible time controlling it. He is driving that car, by the way, probably between 80 and 90 miles an hour right now. He's not going 30 or 40 there on that bare steel. Between 80 and 90 miles an hour, trying to finish out this race. Probably as dangerous a thing as you've seen all afternoon going on right there. Meanwhile, Junior Johnson is spinning around, well out in front. His car almost seemingly bulging with confidence. After getting off to a very bad start, the beginning of this long afternoon in Darlington, he moved up steadily among the leaders, finally took the lead at one point, then dropped back again when he spun out about midway in the race, and somebody tossed a tire. We couldn't catch the number of the car, but things are really coming apart here at the end of the race. Here comes Junior. And there goes the checkered flag. Junior Johnson has won the Southern 500 for 1962. Larry Frank is not going to get second either because Larry has blown a tire and he is limping around out there in the backstretch. So there we see two of the first three cars dropping out in the closing stages, Junior finally winning it all by himself. And Dick Petty there still going around, finishing out on the tireless front wheel. Junior taking a victory lap, or you could call it a safety lap if you want. Just wanted to make sure that he got them all in. Coming in, and as soon as he comes into the pits, Chris Konomacki is down there, and he'll be waiting for him. Some of those 75,000 people, listen to him. Really hoot and holler. And there into the infield goes Larry Frank. See, this car number 66, whom we thought was in the lead, and he may still think he's in the lead because his owner was still contending a while ago. But here's your winner, Junior Johnson.
Johnson, how do you feel? A big victory.
Thank you. Just fine.
That just took it right at the end. $20,000, Junior. What are you going to do with it?
Pay some of my debt.
Come on out of the car so we can all get a look at you, Junior, here. Junior Johnson, a few words. As he came in, a winner, his crew member here on the Jerry O. Pontiac, a happy group, as he gets out of the car, a big, burly, 200-and-some-odd pounder from Wilkes County, North Carolina, getting out of the car. Here he is. Junior, how do you feel physically?
Pretty tough.
How hot was it in there?
Not too awful bad.
Not too awful bad. Did you have any worries at all during the race?
Well, when I spun out over here, blew the tire and spun out, I didn't think I'd ever get back to the front end.
I see. Well, you did a great job. Is there anybody you'd like to say hello to back in Wilkes County?
Yeah, my sister and me.
I see. Well, there it is, Junior Johnson. Here's the rest of the field coming in, and the crowd is going absolutely wild. Now, back to Jim McKay.
Okay, Chris, well, Junior Johnson's the winner, but the word from the Larry Frank pit is that there will be an official protest or a recount demanded, so we better stick around and see how that turns out before this long, wild, and woolly afternoon is done. We'll be back in just a moment with the conclusion of the Southern 500 from Darlington, South Carolina, on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Well, hold your hats, hold everything, because here comes the final surprise of this long and eventful day. The judges have recounted the lap charts again, and lo and behold, there was a mistake. Junior Johnson is not the winner. The winner of the race is Larry Frank of Greenville, South Carolina. So here is the official, final official order of finish. First, Larry Frank of Greenville, South Carolina in a Ford. Second now, Junior Johnson of Ronda, North Carolina in a Pontiac. Third, Marvin Panch of Daytona Beach, Florida in a Ford. Fourth, Dave Pearson of Spartanburg, South Carolina in a Pontiac. And Dick Petty held on to take fifth place in his Plymouth. Now let's take a look forward to next week. Just before we leave Darlington, we'd like to express our thanks to Bob Colvin, Raceway President, and his staff, and to the officials of NASCAR for their assistance. The executive producer of ABC's Wide World of Sports is Rune Arley. Ruidoso's segment of today's program was produced and directed by James Colligan. The Southern 500 was produced by Dick Kirchner. Directed by Mac Hemian. The associate director, Marvin Schlenker. And the technical director, William Morris. Assistant to the executive producer, Chuck Howard. Technical supervisor, Pat Stasi. Technical pickup provided by WSOC-TV, ABC, Charlotte, North Carolina. And now this is Jim McKay speaking for Chris Konomacki and Larry Berleffi, saying so long, you all, from Darlington, South Carolina.